Welcome to worship this morning on the second Sunday of Easter. It's good to remember that Easter is not just a single day or weekend, but 40 days of celebration as we remember Christ risen and promising that he is with us always to the end of time. Dispersed as we are, we worship in his name and we are united in his love. Today I'm delighted that members of both Cause End and Trinity Church in High Wycombe are sharing in leading this service. One of our elders, Alan Yates, will reflect on the main reading from the Bible. Kate will lead the prayers of intercession. And Ali, Debbie, Martin and Marion are taking part too, all from their different homes. My thanks to them. As the Sunday after Easter Day, Easter Sunday, there's often a sense of anticlimax for this day. It's known as Low Sunday. It's a Sunday where often ministers are away and others are having the day off. But this is, in a sense, a reminder that Christ is with us in the highs and the lows of life, the mountaintop experiences and the valleys of our lives. With us in the laughter and in the tears. So let's keep a moment of quiet as I light our peace candle. Peace for our hearts and peace for our world. And so we've come to worship. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. And so we sing the hymn, Christ is alive. Let Christians sing. we come to God in prayer. The cross stands empty to the sky. God of new life, we praise you for the good news you bring to our lives today. Good news for the poor, the frightened, and the isolated. Good news to comfort the disturbed and challenge the comfortable. Good news for all humanity and all creation. For you, great God, are the life giver and the bringer of new life, that living hope we see lived out in Jesus. We thank you for the empty cross and the empty tomb, the promise that he is with us here and now, no longer bound to distant years in Palestine, but saving, healing here and now, and touching every place and time. Forgive us, Lord, when our hearts have been closed to your love and compassion. Forgive us, Lord, when our ears have been closed to your living word and to the cries of our sisters and brothers across the world. Forgive us, Lord, when our minds have been closed to your loving truth and gracious wisdom. Forgive us now, and speak your word of peace. Be assured, Jesus stands among us and says, "Peace be with you." He shows us his wounds, by which we are healed and forgiven, for his love's sake. And then he calls us to follow him once more. Thanks be to God. Amen. This morning I want to take you out into the sunshine, the light of the sun which reminds us of the light of the Son of God, and show you round Causend, the church and its gardens, and graveyard and meadow. So come with me. You start outside the front door of the church by the cross. And then we walk down the path round to the churchyard. Just hidden in that corner. No one can see it, but is our hedgehog home, made by the brownies that meet here normally. And they also planted a tree, which today is surrounded by beautiful primroses. And is coming into blossom. Move on down. To the churchyard proper. Remember many who have served here and in the community. This wall is very special to the church, reminds us where the church community came from. This wall is part of the barn in which the founder of the church, Reverend Thomas Groves, first held services in 1768. So we've not always worshipped in regular church buildings. Barns and homes will do. We move on down to Jackson's Field. And part of that was given to the church some years ago. And we're developing it as a wildlife meadow. We just planted 8 cherry trees growing behind that little barrier of branches and twigs that is a wildlife haven. You can hear the birds singing in the background. So we head back to the church, past the great crosses to remember lives that have been important to loved ones, and the wonderful cherry blossom, a sign of new life, beauty of God's love. And into the children's garden. No children playing here at the moment. But we do have our vine growing in the corner. And the first signs of new leaves. We remember the words of Jesus, "I am the true vine. Whoever dwells in me will bear good fruit." Past the rosemary bush, a symbol of remembrance, and into the link-up garden, a chain linking people, connecting people. A stone to remember a minister who died in post, Gordon Thompson. His widow still worships with the church today. Ruth is a valued member. And then in the corner, we've created a little Easter garden. With the crosses and the empty tomb. Return to the church. Out of the garden, up the steps. Good reminder. Thank you, NHS. We're praying for you. And we come down the side passage of the church, down the little bend. Here's a surprise. What are you doing out here, Henry? Shouldn't be out here. And so we're here back at the front of the church. We come to the front of the church's cross, Easter cross. Christ is risen, he is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Now Debbie, a member here at God's End, is going to read a prayer. And during that prayer, we're going to see a photo that her daughter took recently, a picture of love and hope. So let us pray.
Father, hear the prayer we offer, not for ease that prayer shall be, but for strength that we may ever live our lives courageously. Be our strength in hours of weakness, in our wanderings be our guide, through endeavour, failure, danger. Father, be thou at our side. Amen.
One of the songs that's special to Debbie at the moment is Now is the Time to Worship. And so we're going to sing that now.
Time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before.
Good morning. Let me introduce our two readings for this morning, which both come from the lectionary for the first Sunday after Easter. You know, sometimes when I study the lectionary readings in preparation for a service, I look at them and wonder why on earth they've been put together. Our readings this morning did not cause me any such grief. The first letter of Peter clearly resonates with our reading from John's Gospel. When you hear the first chapter of 1 Peter, listen for the rebirth and resurrection, trials and tribulations, and salvation by faith alone. When you hear John 20, listen with confidence to the sightings of the risen Lord, experience the peace of Christ, and put yourself in Thomas's sandals.
Good morning, everyone. This morning's New Testament reading comes from 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 to 9, and I'm reading from the NIV UK version, entitled A Living Hope. Praise be to the God and Father of the Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he's given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil or fade. This inheritance is kept in heaven for you, who are through faith shielded by God's power, until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. In all this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. These have come so that the proven genuineness of your faith, of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may result in praise and glory and honour when Jesus Christ is revealed. Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy. For you are receiving the end result of your faith, the salvation of your souls. This is the word of the Lord.
Our worship song this morning is Jesus, Hope of the Nations. It's really the only song we could sing at a time like this, when Jesus is our only true hope. Let's join together and worship him.
Jesus, hope of the nations. Jesus, comfort for all who mourn. You are the source of heaven's hope on earth. Jesus, light in the darkness. Jesus, truth in any circumstance. You are the source of heaven's light on earth. History, you lived and died, you broke the chains, you rose to life. You are the hope living in us, you are the rock in whom we trust. You are the light shining for all the world to see. You rose from the dead, conquering fear, a prince of peace, drawing us near. Jesus, our hope, living for all who will receive. Lord, we believe. Jesus, hope of the nations. Jesus, comfort for all who mourn. You are the source of heaven's hope on earth. Jesus, light in the darkness. Jesus, truth in any circumstance. You are the source of heaven's light on earth. In history, you lived and died. You broke the chains, you rose to life. You are the hope living in us. You are the rock in whom we trust. You are the light shining for all the world to see. You rose from the dead, conquering fear, our Prince of Peace, drawing us near. Jesus, our hope, living for all who will receive. Lord, we believe.
believe. I'm reading from John's Gospel, chapter 20. Jesus appears to his disciples. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone's sins, their sins are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Jesus appears to Thomas. Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here, see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." The purpose of John's Gospel. Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written, that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Lord, I pray that you would take these humble words and our thoughts and use them to lead us ever closer to your divine truth. Amen. This morning, I want us to focus on the second half of our Gospel reading, the story of Thomas. But before I do that, I must say a few words about our reading from the first chapter of 1 Peter, because it packs such a punch in a few short verses. The first five verses give us a 60-second summary of the core of our Christian beliefs. It's fantastic, and well worth more than 60 seconds to study. Hint for some of our study groups. But before I move on to John's Gospel, I want to point out the oblique reference to Thomas when in verse 8 Peter says, "Though you have not seen him, you love him." Now, let us look at the second half of our reading from John. I wish I was more like Thomas. No, I don't want to go down in history as a doubter. I think Thomas has been given some bad press because he insisted in putting his finger where the nails were and his hand in Christ's pierced side before he would believe Jesus was alive. Thomas's reputation was further damaged when Jesus told Thomas on his second visitation to the disciples, "Blessed are those who believe without seeing me." And I still wish I was more like Thomas. Defending Thomas for a moment, we must remember firstly that the rest of the disciples were shown, without asking, the nail marks immediately Jesus appeared to them. And secondly, we read earlier in the chapter, when the first disciples rushed to the tomb following Mary's discovery, that he also went in to the tomb and he saw and he believed. I even get the impression that the other disciples did not really believe that Mary had seen Jesus. So Thomas didn't really behave any differently from his fellow disciples. So perhaps we ought not to condemn Thomas too hastily, just because he needed to see before he could believe. And believe something that was truly fantastic in both senses of the word. I wish I was more like Thomas. Thomas had great qualities. He was courageous, decisive, outspokenly honest. On one occasion, he demonstrated his courage when Jesus proposed to go to Bethany, which is a couple of miles to the east of Jerusalem, after the news of Lazarus's illness. Thomas knew that for Jesus to go that close to Jerusalem, he would be inviting serious trouble. And even with that knowledge, Thomas said, "Let us also go and die with him." Thomas did not lack courage. In fact, his courage caused him to say things that others might be thinking, but were too afraid to say. So when he said he would not believe until he saw the marks of the nails, he was probably only voicing things that others had thought before. Nor can we say that Thomas was indecisive. Indecision is not the same as doubt. It is decisive to express clearly your doubts. Then and only then can they be fully addressed by the fellowship. Doubting is not dithering, no. Thomas's only mistake was to have withdrawn from the other disciples after Christ's death, perhaps because he was too grief-stricken to meet his fellow Christians face to face. He sought loneliness rather than fellowship. And maybe there's a message in that for us all here in our social distancing and isolation. It can make a great deal of difference when we separate ourselves from our Christian fellowship. However, once convinced of Christ's resurrection, Thomas's true character was evident in his complete commitment to the risen Lord. A commitment unlikely to be attained by those who glibly accept things without thought or challenge. I wish I was more like Thomas. Would you like to be more like Thomas? Thomas is a clear example to us all of how we are to fulfill Christ's great commission today. Thomas was confident in what he knew and what he didn't know. And Thomas knew that he loved Jesus. Thomas was not afraid of expressing his doubt, and he shared that, rightly so, in fellowship. Having expressed his doubt and seen Christ's response, Thomas was confident that Jesus was his Lord and his God. Remembering that it was not easy to follow Jesus, and we are reminded in 1 Peter, it won't be easy for us either. But with God's help, it will not defeat us. Let me finish with the words from 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 8. We are hard pressed, but never cornered. But bewildered, but never at our wits' end. Hunted, but never abandoned to our fate. Struck down, but never killed. Let us pray. Lord, we pray that you will make us all ever more like Thomas, courageous, honest, loyal, and obedient. Amen. And now please join us in our next hymn, a hymn that reflects the victory cry of Thomas once he saw and believed. He is Lord. He is Lord.
We pray today, gathered not together in body, but in spirit, at this waiting time between the joy of Jesus' resurrection and Pentecost. So we bring ourselves to God in prayer, also at a time of waiting, and in desperate need of God in our own lives and throughout the world. We pray with the usual bidding and response of, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us pray. Our heads and hearts are full of sad daily news of coronavirus affecting countries, communities, workplaces, families and individuals. We hear of huge numbers of people who have died, each one precious to their loved ones and you, God our Creator. We pray for their families, friends, colleagues and acquaintances at this time of shock, grief, bewilderment and loss. Lord our God, you forgive our sins and our selfishness. Continue to change and transform us, focus our prayers and our giving of our very selves, our money, our skills, to make a real difference to the world, both now and for the longer term. Across the globe, we pray for governments urgently and sometimes belatedly trying to contain and counteract the virus. We're horrified by the destruction, despair, desolation and deprivation it's causing. We think of people in developing countries where livelihoods have been wiped out through the total loss of tourism or the cancelling of fast fashion orders, leaving millions of people destitute. We're mindful too of the plague of locusts sweeping across East Africa, affecting millions of people's food harvest and their future survival. Many of these developing countries are dealing with a pandemic without any of the healthcare and economic support that we have. And we pray especially for the Central African Republic, which has just 3 ventilators for a population of 5 million. Guide us in how best to help. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the work of all charities trying to meet increasing needs, but with far fewer resources, financial and people. In Wycombe particularly, we pray for Wycombe Homeless Connection, Wycombe Food Bank and Wycombe Refugee Partnership. Father God, we're aware of and give thanks for the work of these 3 charities. Wycombe alone had a 91% increase in requests for help in the first week of April. We pray too for charities helping people with learning difficulties or poor mental health or suffering domestic abuse, and we particularly think of Mencap, Mind and Wycombe Women's Aid at this time. Guide us in how best to help. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of hope, we pray for farmers struggling not just to make ends meet, but sometimes having to waste good food or milk because they either cannot get workers or the demand for their products has dried up through the closure of restaurants, hotels and other outlets. We give thanks and pray for all key workers, medical staff, carers, managers, cleaners and caterers in hospitals, clinics, hospices and care homes and schools. We pray for teachers, for delivery drivers, for refuse collectors and supermarket workers, for postmen and women, and for bus and train drivers getting people to their places of work, and for people doing all sorts of jobs that are crucial at this time. We give thanks and pray too for all volunteers providing support to so many in our cities, towns and villages. Keep them and their families in your loving care, Lord, we ask. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those living in cramped or substandard conditions, cooped up in close proximity and finding it very difficult and stressful. We remember too those who are alone or isolated or suffering illness in any way. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we pray for those who are grieving, whether their loss is through coronavirus or something else, whether their bereavement is recent or longer ago, sudden or expected, traumatic or a peaceful release. Father God, you know the pain of seeing your precious Son Jesus die on the cross, and we thank you that through his death and resurrection you have given us the promise of life after death with you. Bring light into the darkness and mourning of those who grieve, we pray. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And as we draw our prayers for others and ourselves to a close, let us remember today the words from the book of Romans, chapter 15, verse 13. May God, the source of hope, fill you with all joy and peace by means of your faith in him, so that your hope will continue to grow by the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now we'll close with that wonderful hymn, Christ Be Our Light.
Now the blessing. Let us know the peace that Christ gives and pray that peace for all around us. Let us carry his grace within us and show God's love today. Let us bless each other and all who need our love and prayers this day. Let us share the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen.
Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that thou art. Thou my best thought, by day or by night. Waking or sleeping, thy presence my light. Oh, praise him, oh, praise him. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Let goods and kindred go, this mortal life also. The body they may kill, God's truth abideth still. His kingdom is forever. Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. O my soul, praise him, for he is thy health and salvation. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound, that saved a wretch like me. When darkness seems to hide his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. And the things of earth will grow strangely cleansing flood. Burdens are lifted at Calvary, Calvary, Calvary. Burdens are lifted at Calvary. Jesus is very near. That's how it is with God's love. Once you've experienced it, you spread his love to everyone. You want to pass it on. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah! Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! We are going to see the King. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom.
from power and love. Our God is an awesome God. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. Beyond our galaxy, you are holy, 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 holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Your love never fails, it never gives up, never runs out. Battles and every knee will bow before.
I've seen you move.
I've seen you move.
I've seen you move.
You move the mountains.
And I believe.
And I believe. I'll see you do it again.
You made a way
where there was no way.
And I believe.
And I believe. I'll see you do it again. I'll see you do.
Still be my vision, O Ruler.